at different times in our life, many people are confronted with such a dilemma. We have roamed the streets for years after graduation, and there's no job. We are suffering all manner of indignities from our places of work where we are paid meager wages. Our children are being sent out of schools because we can no longer afford to pay their tuition. Members of our immediate families are dying before our very eyes because we cannot afford the medical bills. We are being ejected from places of abode with nowhere to go because there is no money. Why are we sitting here until we die? That question posed by four lepers is daily being posed by many of our young men and women who have become desperate. And in such a situation, they are also coming to the same conclusion about our country as the lepers did about Samaria. If we stay here, we die. In seeking the way out of their predicament, some now choose armed robbery, some choose prostitution, some choose kidnapping. I have no business with those who choose lives of crime. No matter how hard the situation, nothing should justify criminality. However, there are many who choose traveling out of the country because we have made our society too difficult for them to survive and thrive. Most of these people are honest men and women. Many of them are hardworking, looking for better lives for themselves and their families. The sad bit, however, is that the choices they make do not necessarily lead them on the path of supernatural abundance that became the lot of the Samaria lepers, as many of them end up in the belly of some fishes on the Mediterranean Sea. Pastor Koju, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, in the face of mounting difficulties, many of our young men and women are trooping out of Nigeria because they have lost hope that their lives will change for the better if they remain here. Yet, if Nigeria had provided them with the opportunities for self-actualization, many would most certainly not have embarked on such deadly journeys. As Nigerians, whether in the public or private sectors, we should all be concerned. We should also accept that we have failed these young men and women who have concluded that if they stay here, they die. In recent weeks, many of us must have read heartrending stories in what is now known as the immigration crisis in Europe. But because it sounds so distant, I will share the personal story of someone very close to me. I actually told him to recount his personal experience for me so that we can understand the gravity of the challenge we are dealing with. And I'm reading his story. In 1992, while I was working at Upper Wharf, I saw many of our friends disappear through hiding in ships that were traveling back, loaded with cocoa to Europe, Asia, or South America. We were always bombarded with stories of those who made it, but nobody ever told us of those who did not, including those who died, and majority actually died, while several others ended up as nobody and slaves, even in some West African countries. My first journey started on 2 April 1992 through a ship which carried a flag that resembled that of the United States, and that deceived us into believing it was bound for America. It took several days before the 17 of us that boarded the ship discovered that we had entered a ship that was bound for Brazil, where we were eventually trapped at their wharf for 52 days before we could enter Rio de Janeiro. After roaming the streets for days without any meaningful job, and we were becoming hungry, we boarded another ship to West Africa through Sri Lanka, where we spent another 3 months before the ship eventually came to forcefully ask us to disembark at Tema Port in Ghana. From there, the Nigerians among us traveled back home in February 1993 after 10 months. The second leg of my journey in February 1994 was through the human traffickers called the Big Brothers at the stadium area of Lagos. I was directed there and I met these people who sweet-talked me and the others into believing they could facilitate our travel to Europe with or without international passports. We were charged $300 each. After paying the consultancy fees, I had $122 cash left, which I changed into $1, $5, $10, and $20 denominations as traveling allowance. We were taken from Lagos to Kano, where we met many other young men and women from all over Nigeria who also wanted to embark on what was then called Europe by road. We first converged in Kano before proceeding to Maradi, a border town between Niger Republic and Nigeria. That was the place where many travelers got stuck as their traffickers abandoned them. On my part, I went through a night journey to Agadez and to Asamaka, a desert part of Niger Republic, where our trafficker also told us that our money had been exhausted and that anyone who wanted to proceed had to pay another round of fees. The journey terminated for many at this point, but I joined those that still had money strapped to their bodies to form a new group that would travel without a trafficker. Since we did not know our way, we got a map and paid to hire some Land Rover vehicles for the all-night journey that took us to Gwazam, a border town between Niger and Algeria. By that time, some of us that left Kano had either died or got stranded at one town or another, either for lack of money or through illness. From Gwazam, we paid our way through Mount Ogan, where we encountered the Buzos, the Arab Nigerian who were fighting for separate country from Niger Republic. We were robbed by those men, but some of us were simply lucky to have survived their brutality. When they accosted us, they shot at our vehicles, killing our two drivers. They sacked our bodies for money, but as they did that, I quickly buried part of my money in the sand where I laid and released only the remaining part to them. When they left us, two co-travelers, one of them a Ghanaian, took over the wheels while all of us were reading maps to locate the road in the desert, in a route we didn't know. But we were fortunate to reach a village where some people collected money to lead us to Tamara Set, an Algeria border town. It was in the town that we were arrested, but we bribed our way out. 26 of us left Asamaka, but only 11 reached Gwazam, and 5 reached Tamares, and only 4 of us were discharged from prison by the police. 4 out of 26. We met several Nigerians and Ghanaians at Tamaraset, and we formed another group to proceed to Libya through Saleh, en route Taba. Chose to proceed to Algiers. At Salah, we converged to form another team of 20 that will proceed to Taba in Libya, where I spent about 2 months before I got the opening to move with some other people to Tripoli. 8 months after I left Nigeria, I eventually arrived at Tripoli and was ushered into an abandoned building called No Man's Land, the former American embassy where several Nigerians, Ghanaians, and other illegal immigrants were living. At that period, Libya was very good and work was easy to find if one was ready to work. I joined others to move to Benghazi, where I worked in the laying of crude oil pipes and painting them with anti-rust and some other chemicals to prevent already treated pipes from leaking before they were buried in the sun's hot sun. Within 3 months in Libya, I succeeded in saving about 200 dinars, which carried the same exchange rate as the American dollar. So with that, that meant I had $200 with me. After several weeks, we succeeded in boarding a fish ferry, which charged us $100 each to the Sicily island in Italy. From there, we paid some corrupt officers who provided way to Rome, where I was arrested and spent 3 months in prison without trial. It was while awaiting repatriation to Nigeria in prison that I met an Arab Indian who secured my release on condition that I would be his drug courier from Rome to Barcelona in Spain. But on the first leg of my journey, which was to Almeria in Spain, I was arrested with the drug. But somehow, the men came and collected their drug while I was repatriated to South Africa because I carried their passport given to me by the drug merchants before embarking on the trip. My experience in South Africa, where I spent almost a year, is better forgotten. When I couldn't find any serious job and was running out of money, I concluded that I was better off coming back home like the prodigal son. I went to the Nigerian embassy to secure an international passport, but for 4 months after collecting my money, they could not produce any passport. When the officials started telling me all kinds of stories, I met someone who advised me to go to either the embassy of Sierra Leone or that of Ghana so I could secure their passport. Within 2 weeks, I got a Sierra Leonean passport, and that of Ghana also came within a month. With that, I bought my ticket and arrived in Nigeria as a Sierra Leonean. But amen. But despite having arrived back in my country, I could not go because I saw myself as a failure, and I didn't want to see any known person, even when I was missing my family. Eventually, they got to know I was alive, and my brother's wife helped in the process of my rehabilitation. She counseled me that there is no shortcut to success and advised that I needed to go to school. I eventually get admission to Olabisi Onabanjo University, completed my degree, and I am now happily married with children and running my own business.